Psalm 95 out of the Message Bible. Come, let us shout praises to God. Raise the roof of the rock of our salvation, who saved us. Let's march into his presence with singing, lifting the rafters with our hymns. And why? Because God is the best high king above all other gods. Amen. Let us stand before the morning hymn.
Good morning, Brentwood.
Good morning.
Let's all lift our voices as we sing, Lift Every Voice.
Ring with the heart, Lord, we fall.
As we prepare our hearts and minds for the Holy Communion, let us first hear from Deacon Cheryl Macbeth and read together from your communion response that's found on your green sheet.
Let's read. As we prepare to approach the Lord's table, let us come with a spirit of humility, repentance, and thanksgiving.
God, who sees us fully, touch and empower us so that our lives be remarkable testimonies of your presence.
As we partake of this bread and wine, let us remember Jesus Christ and the sacrifice he made for us.
Abide in us, fill us with the life-giving power of the Holy Spirit, so that we will be forever changed. Amen.
Let us bow. Eternal God, our Father, which art in heaven, God of love, God of life everlasting, God of new life in you. Oh, Father, we thank you for this opportunity. You said as oft as we do this, we do show the Lord's coming until he comes. Oh, we thank you for this opportunity to come together, first admitting that we have failed, Father. No matter how good we've been, we have sinned and fallen short. The thanks be to God our Father who provided a lamb. Oh, thank you for the Lamb of God who taketh away the sins of the world. Forgive us, Father. Wash us clean in the blood of the Lamb that we might come together, Lord. In your sight pierce the driven snow, Lord. Oh, thank you, Father. Now, Father, we pray that you just touch our hearts and souls, that we may be on one accord as we partake of this body and this blood, Lord, symbolizing your body that was given and your blood that fell and that covers us. Thank you, Father. Thank you that you made a way that we might be reconciled back to you. Thank you for your people who are gathered this day. Thank you for the preacher that will stand and proclaim your word. Thank you for your Holy Ghost that empowers us all. Thank you, Father. It is in the holy name of Jesus the Christ that we do pray. And to thine be the glory. Amen.
Thank you.
you all stand with me if your health permits? And as Jesus and his disciples were gathered in that upper room, as he broke the bread and blessed it, he lifted the bread and says, "This represents my body that will be given for you. Take and eat all of it." And then he lifted the cup of the fruit of the vine and said, "This represents my blood that will be shed for you. Drink ye all of it." And then they went away together singing hymns.
The Lord this morning. This song says, "I have a testimony." And if you have a testimony, just stand to your feet. Let me see you. Just your mere presence here in the house of God today is a testimony. Song says, "As I look back over my life, that I'm here today. That's my testimony. One day he set me free. The Lord has been good to me. Well, I can truly say, I can truly that I've been blessed. I can truly say that I've been blessed. I can truly say that I've been blessed.
What a blessing to know that you've been tested and that you have a testimony. Amen, amen. God be praised. We would like to ask if you are a first-time visitor to Brentwood that you would stand that we might recognize you on this morning. How many do we have this morning? This is your first time here. Please stand. That's one. Amen. Amen. God be praised. Thank you, ma'am, for coming this morning. Now, point to the person that invited you. Are they here? Can you see them? Point to that person. So now you invited me. Now you stand. Amen. Thank you for getting them here this morning. We're so excited that you are a guest here. They have given you a card, and we're going to ask you to fill out that visitor's card, the bottom portion on both sides. And when you have completed that card, please place it in one of the offering plates as it passes by on this morning. Amen?
Amen.
We want you to keep your spiritual antennas up because there's a blessing coming your way, and we don't want you to miss your blessing. Amen? Now, for the rest of us, I want to remind us again, and I'm going to try to say this, we're going to say this every Sunday, because we want us to know why we exist at Brentwood. And the Brentwood Baptist Church exists to serve the kingdom of God and to extend the gospel of Jesus Christ by doing three things. What three things? Number one, please repeat after me, reaching people.
Reaching people.
Developing believers.
Developing believers.
And strengthening missions. That's why we exist as a local congregation. Yes. Amen?
Amen?
And so we need for every member, every ministry, every organization, anybody who is affiliated with Brentwood to know that that is the primary mission statement for the Brentwood Baptist Church.
That's right.
Amen?
That's right. Amen.
Because we want everyone to be a part of this experience of the Brentwood Baptist Church, because we are the church where Christ is
the main attraction.
Now, right quick, I want you to do this for me. Turn to the person to your left and tell them, it's so good to be sitting by you.
As we prepare now to receive our morning tithes and our offering, we pass the place twice. The first time is for missions. The second time is for our tithe and our offering. You were probably given an envelope when you entered this morning with Pastor's picture on it. Starting this Wednesday, the 10th, at 7 o'clock p.m., Reverend Andrew Berry and the Barber's Chapel Choir will be here leading us in worship. Let's give God praise for that. That's his grandmother clapping down front. And that's his aunt, too. Huh? And his aunt clapping down front. And then on Sunday at 7:45 and 10:45, Dr. Ralph Douglas West, from the Proud Pastor of the Church Without Walls, will be our special guest. Let's give God praise for that. Also, Brentwood, so we want to honor the man of God and our First Lady, Sister Ratliff. Sister Ratliff, stand, sister. Come on, y'all, 36 years of pastoral leadership. Bless you, sister. 36 years. Amen. Yeah, we could do so much better than that, y'all. I mean, we could do better than that. Come on, let's celebrate the woman of God and the man of God. 36 years of pastoral leadership. Amen. Amen. And so we want to celebrate our First Lady and our pastor on this coming Wednesday and Sunday. And I want you to come in. I want you to be attendance. I want you to come and be in attendance because we have guests coming. And the worst thing you can do is invite guests and you're not here. So I want you here, and I want you in the place. We have asked all of our organizations to sit together and be represented together. And so we definitely want to fill this place up on this Wednesday and also this Sunday. And so, Brentwood, we've asked each member to give a minimum gift of $75 to our pastor in appreciation. Bless you, brother. Our pastor in appreciation of his pastoral anniversary. So let's make sure that we get those envelopes, especially if you're not going to be here Wednesday and you're not going to be here Sunday. Raise your hand if you're not going to be here Wednesday and you're not going to be here Sunday because you have work obligations or you got to go out of town. I want to make sure you get an envelope today. I'm serious. I am so serious. I want to make sure you get one today. So everybody's going to be here this coming Wednesday and this coming Sunday, right?
Yeah.
So this place is going to be filled.
Yeah.
All right. I'm counting on it. I'm counting on it. So we want to bless our pastor and bless our First Lady for 36 years of pastoral leadership. They are the caretakers for our soul. And so we definitely want to be a blessing to them. We pass the place twice. The first time is for missions. The second time is for our tithe and our offering. You were given the sheet when you entered. Our offertory reading is found on that sheet. And Brentwood, is offering time.
Yeah.
Y'all seem so excited. So excited. And you ought to be excited when God has blessed you to give back.
Amen.
You ought to be excited. Come on, let's where's my, okay, where are we? Okay, let's read together. Lord, I thank you today for the ability and the willingness to offer you my time, my talent, and my tent. I dare not come into your house empty-handed. I'm standing on the promises of God. Amen.
Today we are having our African American Author Showcase, and that is where we invite in authors from across the city, African American authors, who, as we all know, face additional struggles when trying to get their works out before the people. And so we have established this forum for them to be able to come in to do that. And today we have five artists or authors that are here, and we ask that immediately following this service, if you would visit both the Grand Hall and the Carport side to support them. Amen?
Amen.
And one of the authors that is with us today is Brenda White. Wave your hand, Brenda. Amen. Amen. Welcome. She has written a novel entitled The Final Word. And so we ask that you go over. She is on the Carport side. The other authors are Charles Martin, Beretta Duke, and Derek Muhammad. And I did not get their books before I came in, but they will all be on the Carport side. And then yours truly will be on the Grand Hall with three of my books, Who Do You Say He Is?, Jesus and the Devil Used to Be Friends, Jesus Wept, A Plan of Action, and The Melanin Factor, which is a novel. So please come over and support. And even if you don't buy, just say a kind word. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Good morning, Brentwood.
Good morning.
We want to thank our Sunday School Department for sponsoring the Sunday School Equipping Institute on yesterday. If there are committee members here, please stand. Any committee members here? Amen. Sister Jackie Kersey headed that committee. Thank you so much. Awesome. The Samuel DeWitt Proctor Conference will be held on February the 15th through the 18th at the Omni Hotel. On Monday night, February the 15th, we will host a worship service here at 6:30 p.m. Reverend George Cummings, pastor of Imani Community Church in Oakland, California, will be preaching. We are the host church, and we want you to come in big numbers to support the conference. Amen?
Amen.
A few Sundays ago, you received a survey. We would love to receive your feedback on classes, Bible study classes, or topics that you would like us to include in Wednesday night service. You may visit our website to complete the survey or pick up a copy at the receptionist desk. So, if you received the survey a few weeks ago, indicates that you have not completed it. How many of you are interested in Bible study? A few of you. Shall I assume that the rest of you are actively engaged in a Bible study? Help me, Lord. So, if you would be so kind, please complete the survey and let us know. Amen?
Amen?
Today's altar arrangement was donated in memory of Lucius and Jimmy Mitchell by Michael and Davy Mitchell. Aren't they beautiful? Is Brandon Dudley present? Good morning, Brandon. You stand? Brandon is a candidate for Harris County Tax Assessor Collector. Nikita Harmon, good morning. Nikita is candidate for 176 Harris County Criminal Court. Ursula Hall, are you present? Okay. Well, Ursula is a candidate for the 165th Civil District Court. Amen? Also this morning when you entered, you were given an informational sheet with a list of those families who lost loved ones or were sick and shut in. We ask that you remember in prayer this morning, Brother Ate Vidal, who is in Methodist Hospital. Amen? Those are our announcements for today. Thank you.
to walk with me. I want Jesus to walk with me.
Program based out of New York that has prepared these Lenten devotionals. And so there's one for every day starting this coming Wednesday, Ash Wednesday, and it goes all the way up to Easter Sunday morning. They are written by African-American pastors around the country, Terry Mackey, Ralph West, and myself are the three of the 40 that are from Houston. And so I hope that you will take those and use those as devotional guides as we walk the 40 days leading up to Easter. It begins on Wednesday. There's an envelope there that you would encourage you to put an offering in at the, you could do it anytime and drop it in our offering plate. It is a nonprofit ministry, and they take those dollars to publish this and to also do foreign mission work. And so we are participating with them this year, and I hope that you will find them to be very encouraging. I have begun to read them, kind of out of order since it doesn't start till Wednesday, but I hope that you will do that and put something in an envelope. They're encouraging you to do a dollar a day, which is $40. You can just write one check for $40. The instructions are all in there, but I hope you will participate with us in this project. Amen?
Amen.
Joshua Addison Griffin, would you stand? He is our I think number 53 or 54 Eagle Scout here at the Brentwood Church. Let's give it up. Let's give it up. My man Josh. Amen. Psalm 27. This year's series of messages have all been to encourage you, to challenge you, to elevate your expectations, to increase your confidence in God. Psalm 27 was written by David as a very integral part of his development. It is during that period where he has now ascended as king. He has been reflective, and Psalm 27 becomes the text that I want to use today. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? But when the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell.
That's right.
Though an host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this will I be confident. One thing have I desired of the Lord, that I will seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble, he shall hide me. In his pavilion, in the secret of his tabernacle, shall he hide me. He shall set me upon a rock. And now shall mine head be lifted up above mine enemies round about me. Therefore will I offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises unto the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice. Have mercy also upon me and answer me. When thou sayest, seek ye my face, my heart said unto thee, thy face, Lord, will I seek. Hide not thy face far from me, but not put not thy servant away in anger. Thou hast been my help. Leave me not, neither forsake me, O God of my salvation. When my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take me up. Teach me thy way, O Lord, and lead me in a plain path because of mine enemies. Deliver me not over unto the will of mine enemies, for false witnesses are risen up against me, and such as breathe out cruelty. I had fainted unless I had believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. He writes those words, ascending to the office of king as prophesied, only to discover that elevation brought haters and schemers. Even his own son, one of his sons, tried to overthrow him.
Right.
And there he declares in those five books, number 23, number 24, number 27, 29, and 31, he refers with consistency his dependence, his reliance, his trust in God. I want to talk about that. In God we trust. In 1861, as our government was being formed and as it was taking its shape, there was this reminder that we needed to do something to declare the Christian dependency upon God. Legislation was presented, 1861. Legislation was presented, 1837. Legislation was actually put in place in 1867. Upon the fragile, if you would, ripping apart of our nation during the Civil War. And finally, after several recommendations, it was reduced to these words. It used to be country, nation, God. And finally, they condensed it and put those words in God we trust. It is tempting to criticize this nation for how far we are from holding up that promise. Started out on our coins, 1837, 1861, it moved to our paper. And on every dollar bill you got, every currency you have, those words are on there. Ah. David says, knowing his plight and his condition, Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? There are difficult days ahead. There are difficult days ahead. I repeat, there are difficult days ahead. We face interesting economic challenges, interesting political challenges. We got a lot to deal with this year. And the natural response is fear. Folk talk a lot of talk, even in these campaigns, to just instill fear.
That's right.
If they can get you scared,
That's right.
Then your solidity
is
challenged. Your stability is challenged.
Right.
David found himself up against warring armies, but then within his family, he found also no comfort. And he writes this, according to all the authorities, against the backdrop of his regaining his confidence. That's why I want to talk about that. In God, we trust. Well, let's look at it. Because it's tremendous. King James I use today because the literary flow is always so much more moving than some of the newer translations. And there are literally four movements here. Walk with me and I'll show them to you.
Okay.
The first one is this declaration that we all read. For he is the strength of my life. Who here today needs to declare publicly that the Lord is my light and my salvation?
That's right.
In the darkness that creeps around us.
Oh, yeah.
This is a good time to preach this sermon because early in the morning it seems like the sun comes up later. Dusk comes early. Light is squeezed between those two. And we have less light than we do have darkness. When I visited Alaska several times, you go there, some days, some seasons, there's more darkness than there is light. And then you go back in the fall and more light than there's darkness. And so they had shutters in my room. I was supposed to go to a 12 o'clock meeting. And the shutters were there. I didn't know what time it was. I had slept. I'm a morning person. I woke up, but I looked out and it was dark. So I said, I'll go back to bed. Came and knocked on my door of the room and said, Dr. Ratliff, we only got 30 minutes. I said, you do what? And so we're supposed to be somewhere. They told me at 12 o'clock. I said, I'm there in revival. I was supposed to speak at noon and then speak again that night. Oh, I jumped up. I was ready. And we got out and raced to this restaurant. Pitcher lunch in the pitch dark. 4 o'clock came time to go and go get ready to go back to church. Picture coming to 7 o'clock service and the sun is at its height. David experienced what they experienced in those Arctic climates tilting. Anybody here ever been at a point when you thought it should have been dark, but it was light? Or you thought it should have been light, and it was dark? David says, I made it to the top, I'm the king. But the wicked, even my enemies, come upon me to eat my flesh. But because my confidence is in you, they stumble and fail. Seems like a crowd is encamping about me, but my heart shall not fear. And though there's war with people around me on the barriers and the boundaries of my kingdom, in thee will I place my confidence. I don't know what you're up against. I don't know what wall you got your back up against. I don't know what report you're waiting on. I don't know what condition your stuff is in. But in God, we trust. I'm trying to help somebody because many of us are walking timidly, looking over our shoulders, jumping every time a foreign sound comes. One thing have I desired of the Lord that I'll seek after. Now, I want to stop there because a lot of y'all desire stuff, but you don't seek after it. When you want something from God, you got to seek after it.
Right.
Ask, and it shall be given. Seek. I want to challenge you today, because that's where I am. I'm so glad that I've learned to seek after that which I desire. That I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life. I might come to church to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. Many people say you don't have to come to church. And you don't have to come to church. But it's encouraged because there's something that happens when two or three get together in his name. And when 200 or 300 get together. His spirit moves from heart to heart and breast to breast. You can have a good time by yourself, but oh, he says, when I come to his temple, for in the time of trouble, he shall hide me in his pavilion and in his tabernacle. In other words, there was this tent outside the temple. And then there was the inner temple, which was the tabernacle. And you offered your sacrifices inside. He said, but even before I get close up, he will hide me in his pavilion. And he'll set me upon a rock. You ought to be thankful, hallelujah, today, that when you put your trust in God, in times like these, you need a Savior. In times like these, you need an anchor. Be very sure. Be very sure that your anchor holds and grips the solid rock. This rock is Jesus. And now shall my head be lifted up above my enemies round about me. My God, that's something when you can know folk around you don't, they hating on you and they don't want you to succeed. And David says, my head was above. It was lifted up above my enemies. It's one of them texts. I just want to preach the text. It just preaches itself. But I want to highlight for you, because I will offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. He just told you he would hide him in his pavilion and in the secret of his tabernacle. Now he says, now when I do get to the tabernacle, guess what I'm going to give him? Sacrifices of joy. God delivered me from sourpuss Christians. They're always whining, always.
always complaining. They ain't got no joy. The joy of the Lord is my strength.
The challenge of this text is that this David, he says, I'll sing. Yes, I'll sing praises unto the Lord. Oh, my God. Because I'm going to get to his pavilion. I'm going to get to the tabernacle. But when I get there, I'm going to offer sacrifices of joy. So this morning, we ceremoniously participated collectively in communion. Ah, I'm afraid, and the reason why we moved communion 20 years ago from the bottom of the service to the top of the service is because most of us disrespected communion.
You're right.
You came and you got good singing, good preaching, and gave your offering. And time said, now let us prepare for communion, Lord's Supper. And then folks started putting their fingers up, their old Baptist finger up, and start walking out the door.
That's right.
And I sat through that for about 10 years. I couldn't take it anymore. So let's elevate this, because we forgot the reason we could come to the temple and draw near the tabernacle was because there was a fountain filled with blood drawn from Emmanuel's veins.
That's right.
And we elevated that and put it prominently before the offering or the sermon, so that you won't forget why you ought to have a sacrifice of joy. Too many of us, thank God for everything. New job, new boo, new house, new car, raise. But you ought to put first on that list, thank God for my salvation. Thank God for saving me. Thank God for picking me up and turning me around. Thank God. So we structurally redesigned the worship. Some of y'all may not know. I wonder why Brentwood always does it first. And then other churches I go to, the church I grew up in, it was at the end. Because you didn't respect the ordinance, the communion, the Lord's Supper. For if that did not happen, everything else would be moot.
That's right.
He would just have given you a car, a boo, a house, or a raise with no salvation. Oh, here, then he shifts gears, because the first six verses is all about praise and confidence. But then he says, hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice, have mercy also upon me and answer me. He shifts from praise to cry. I argue that your crying is in direct proportion to your praise.
All right.
And the reason why some of y'all don't cry, because you don't praise. And sometimes the reason you don't praise is because you ain't had to cry. But when you cry, I love the Lord because he heard my cry. And he pitied. Long as I live, and trouble will rise, I'll hasten to his throne. To monitor your praise is not to suggest that there is some mode that you lock yourself into. I'm just trying to prepare you so that when you do cry,
the
automatic response to that ought to be praise.
That's right.
You
may not praise him every time you walk into Brentwood, but I promise you there are going to be some weeks when you had to go to him by yourself. And you had to pray for that child, pray for that grandchild, pray for your finances, pray for your health. And the louder your cry, the greater your praise. Don't get it twisted. You will cry sometimes. Trouble in my way, I have to cry sometimes. But Jesus will fix it. Well, since I cried, guess what verse said? 8 said, you said, seek my face. And my heart said, thy face will I see. Hide not thy face from me. Notice the transition. Verse 8 and 9 is what we call a couplet. Verse 8 says, seek my face. I said, I will. Then verse 9 says, hide not your face from me. I'm seeking your face. Don't you hide it, God. Put not thy servant away in anger. Because I know what I'm coming to you for is probably a result of something that could anger you. Because I really ain't hollering at him if I've been good. All right. All right. But because I failed in some way and got myself in a pickle, I'm going to come to you, oh God. You said, seek my face. I will seek your face. But don't you hide your face from me.
That's all right. That's all right.
In anger. Thou hast been my help. Leave me not, neither forsake me. Do you get the movement? You've been my help. Don't leave me. Don't forsake me. Because you are the God of my salvation. Some of you have not prayed like you ought to pray. Some of you have not sought God like you should seek him. Many of us wait to the very last minute after we done messed it up. And we use God as a last resort. As you mature in your faith, David says, you do that first.
That's right.
Go to him first. Lord, I'm getting ready to go for an interview. Lord, I got contract negotiations this week. Lord, I don't know where my child is. Lord, they ain't called me. Lord, husband cutting the food, wife cutting the food. Just a mess. David said, don't wait till it gets that bad. Seek my face. Why? Because you are the God of my salvation. When my mother and my father, that was one thing, one of them forsake you, but David writes this thing, he said, both of them.
Right.
When mother and father forsake me, then the Lord will take me up. Several translations. One says he'll take me in. One says takes me up. One says he will take me, period. The preposition does not necessarily give the apposition to the reality of what God's going to do. All they know is that God's going to take care of me. I don't know if he's going to take me up, take me in, but he's going to take care of me. David wrote this, hallelujah. After he wrote the 23rd Psalm, after he wrote the pretty stuff, oh my God, when the reality set in, he's not poetic here. He moves the prose and begins to challenge us. Let me move. So the first 6 verses is praise. The next four verses is crying. Then he has a nerve to say, teach me. And lead me in a plain path. I don't want no confusion. I don't want no mixed signals. I don't want to have to interpret nothing. Teach me. Lead me. Make it plain in a plain path because of my enemies. Then he says in verse 12, what? Deliver me. Don't you deliver me over to my enemies. But false witnesses are risen up against me, and such as breathe out cruelty. David writes this verse, which is in contrast to in verse in the 117 division and also in 37th division. Because what he does here is he says, for false witnesses are risen up against me, and such as breathe out cruelty. What about when the witnesses ain't false? Anybody had to go to God and what they were saying was true? Psalm 27, 117, and in 37. That's the case. The case is, hallelujah, I've slipped, I've fallen. But Lord, thou has been my dwelling place.
That's right.
Woo! Yes, sir. When you start getting to that point, when you trust in God, even when you're wrong, trust Him. Even when you're right, trust Him. Teach me, O God, thy way. Make it a plain way. And don't you deliver me to my enemies, for false witnesses have written against me, and such breathe out cruelty. And then verse 13, he gives his testimony. I had fainted. Woo! Unless I had believed to see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. I mean, I would have just thrown in the towel. I would have quit. But I believed. Now, the brilliance of the Hebrew is written such that, listen to this now, I don't just believe the goodness of the Lord. I believe to see. It's one thing to believe God is good. It's another thing to believe to see that the Lord is good. Oh, my God. Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. Open mine eyes that I might see. I would have fainted. But guess what? I had not believed to see the goodness of the Lord. When last time have you seen the goodness of the Lord? I was talking to somebody this morning. One of the sad things in life is to become an ingrate. And I argue that ingratitude is in direct proportion to your inability to see. Because a fool, hallelujah, ought to be able to see what God is up to and what God is doing. You ought to be able to see, not believe, but believe to see. I gotta believe, I gotta believe, but I need to believe to see God's hand. Navigating God's hand, guiding God's hand. Woo! I love this text. When I get in the thick of stuff, I read this for my own edification. because I need to believe. Lord, I want you to, I want to see it. I know it's there. I want you to, I want to see it. I want to see you make a way out of no way. See, those are literary phraseologies that our people have passed down to us, and because of repetition and rhetorical ability, we don't have enough, hallelujah, spiritual sight. So that's why your grandmama would holler in church when they say he be a mother for the motherless.
That's right, that's right.
Because they had lived to see what it meant for God to make a way, to open doors that men had shut.
That's right, that's right.
To make crooked ways.
Lord help me. Lord help
me. I believed so I could see that you are a bridge over troubled water. Are you at a point yet where you can see God doing all of that? David said, I had to get in a pickle. My enemies had to come around me. My children had to be cutting the food. I had been elevated to what you had promised me. But I had to believe to see. Ah, the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Not in hell, not in Sheol, not in the grave. That's how the old deacons used to pray, Lord. Once more and again. Ah, you know it. That's it. Somebody just said, knee bowed. Body bent. Be able to see God. In this year of election, we got to be able to. I don't care how many crazy ones they got on this side. I don't know how many they got on that side. But we got to be able to see God in everything.
That's right.
We got to trust him that whoever man elevates to that post,
right.
That our trust is in thee, O God. We will participate in the process. We will make our votes count. We will. But my trust
that's right.
Is in the Lord. For when mother and father forsake me, when the government forsakes me,
that's right.
When I don't have enough sense to know the difference between a redneck and a pink neck,
My trust
is in thee.
Yes.
Whatever camp I land in, Republican, Democrat, whatever, my trust is not in them. Lord, you may use them to get me where you want me to be, but my trust is in thee. Finally, verse 14 says, wait on the Lord. Don't take matters into your own hands. Wait. Be of good courage. And he will strengthen your heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. For they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up wings like eagles. Run, not be weary. Walk, and not faint. Oh, my God. In God, we
trust. 1861, they put it on the coins. Later, they put it on the paper, the currency. But may God put it in our hearts. May God, may we walk to the point where we can trust Him. In Thee, O God, I put my trust. Saints sing it this way: I will trust in the Lord till I die. I'm going to treat my neighbor right. I'm going to trust in the Lord. And when you trust Him, see, C.A. Timothy wrote in his song, if you trust Him and never doubt, He'll surely bring you out. Well, he was just trying to get some lyrics to rhyme, because that's theologically untrue. Uh-huh. Even when you doubt Him, He'll still bring you out. Anybody here beside me honest enough to tell the truth? That there have been times when I've doubted Him. Didn't know how I was going to get through. Didn't know how I was going to get out. But He still brought me out. The Lord is my light and my salvation.
That's right. That's right.
Whom shall I fear?
That's right. That's right.
For in the time of trouble.
That's right.
Yeah. Maybe you ain't never been in no trouble. I have. He shall hide me.
Boy, boy.
When my enemies and my foes.
Right.
See, you destroy me.
Yeah.
Then you gotta have enough sense to figure out who's your enemy and who's your foe.
Yeah. All right now. All right.
They're enemies, they're foes, they're adversaries.
Uh-huh.
David said, I got two out of three right here.
Right.
He's going to use that term adversary later. But you see, an enemy. Uh-huh. Hallelujah. Whew. Okay, let me start with the foe. The foe wants to fight you. He wants you down. The enemy wants you down and out. I'm trying to give you a working definition. Look them up when you get home. Enemy, foe, adversary. And you got folk listed as an enemy who ain't really your enemy. They just your foe. So I believe God sent some of y'all here just to worry me. I think you love me. I think you love me, but you just worry me. That's a foe. An enemy wants you down and out. There's some of y'all still around who are enemies. But David said, you will hide me. In his pavilion.
That's right, that's right, that's right.
I'll never forget, in the heat of our storm in 2003, I considered leaving this church and resigning and taking a couple thousand of y'all and rent Hannah Hall or over there at Texas Southern and start the Greater Improved Baptist Church. No lie. Because the enemies were encircling and coming up close. And one night I was going to the car and I put my key in my car door to unlock it, and as I looked across the campus, the Spirit spoke to me as clearly as I'm talking to you right now. Where can you go? And so I decided not to stay here and fight. Jesse and Lydia, I got home on the piano and just started playing. Doris was already upstairs, and I just started playing that old song. Where could I go but to the Lord? Living below
sinful world hardly comfort can afford. Where could I go but to the Lord? God will speak to you.
Mm-hmm. Yes, he will. Yes, he will. Yes, he will.
At the very time that you need a voice. Then they wrote the song based on this hymn, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I fear?" Walk in that office, walk in that house, walk in your whatever you got up against you. For he will strengthen thine heart. That's the message for the morning.
Thank you.
Brentwood for coming this morning, and thank you. And we look forward to what God is going to do in your life. Yes. If you will just maintain your trust in Him.
That's right.
In God we trust, on our coins, on our currency. But may God plant it on our hearts. Wednesday night, one of our sons, Reverend Andrew Barry, will be here. Look forward to every one of you who can come and will come to come and be encouragement to him and to me. Amen. 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 It's really my anniversary, but I do want you to come hear him. Amen. God bless you. All right. Use those devotionals. They are going to be valued and valuable to your life. Amen.
Amen.
All right. I've got to teach Sunday school to the youth today, so I'm going that away. And you're going to go your way, and see you soon. Love you. Bye.